trauma inside of you, you bring an oasis wherever you go. He will cause you and everything in your life to blossom. And if you'll just trust him, he can use you way beyond what you can imagine. God's plan for us is to flourish in every area of our life, our spirit, soul, and our body, personally, marriage, family, business. You're going to flourish like the palm tree, you're going to grow like the cedar, and you're going to carry that oasis where whoever you meet, if you go preach in a church, if you just meet someone on the street, you're carrying that oasis. You bring that refreshing, you bring that life everywhere that you go. You become the oasis.
This is a revival, fire, fall on us. Becoming more and more like Jesus when he took up and bore the cross. God, you help me walk the fire. I am higher than before. Your joy has helped me make it without fear or compromise. You lift me up. Till the storm blows over and I'm still standing here. Oh, you set my feet on the solid rock. Till the storm blows over and I'm still standing here. Oh, you set my feet on the solid rock. High up on the mountaintop. Till the storm blows over and I'm still standing here. I can see. There's a reason for this life inside me. One name above all names, Jesus. Yes, it's Jesus. There's a reason for this hope. There's a reason for this peace that I know. One worthy of our praise, Jesus. Yes, it's Jesus.
So let's start right.
just wanna be with you. I just wanna be with you. Yes, the world will bow down and say you are God.
Every man
will bow down and say you are King. So let's start.
Thank you.
sleeping in the room. Here comes the glory of the Lord. Here comes the glory of the Lord. Sweeping in the room. Here comes the glory of the Lord.
here comes heaven. Here comes heaven.
He's my shepherd. He goes before me. Defender behind me.
I won't fear.
I won't fear.
I'm filled with anointing.
And I'm filled with anointing.
Oh, my cup.
My cup's overflowing.
No weapon.
No weapon can harm me.
I won't
fear. I won't fear.
Oh, sing high.
My comfort.
Wonderful Jesus. Wonderful Jesus. Wonderful Jesus. Just lift those hands and just thank Him right now. We worship You. We worship You. We worship You. Siria namoro po sandere torarapati. Oh, we worship You. We worship You. Oh, wonderful Jesus. You're so awesome, Lord. Father, this morning as we come into this place, we come with holy hands and lift those hands up without wrath or doubting. And we put our eyes on You, Lord Jesus, as we've come to lift up that name that is above every name, that name that has authority in three worlds. In heaven before God, in earth before man and kings, and in hell, the demons tremble at the mention of that name. And as Your people have come today, I pray that You will touch every single life here, that not one person will leave You the same way they walked in these doors, but that You touch those that are watching by way of television across America and then on all the streams and wherever the satellite coverage goes around the world. Let Your very presence invade their homes. That today people will be saved, healed, set free, delivered, and the power of the enemy shall be broken and the yoke shall be destroyed. And we thank You for it. Thank You for what You've done with this new sanctuary, Lord. Thank You so much. In 5.5 months, we saw a miracle, Lord. And even as we've laid aside the past 3 weeks to dedicate this place, we dedicate this place to the move of the Holy Ghost, to the book of Acts, to signs and wonders and miracles. And we thank You for it. And now, Lord, as we extend into the fourth week, this next week, that You have Your way in the hearts of Your people, that cause these meetings to have far-reaching results, even unto eternity. Thank You, Lord. Thank You, Lord. La presencia de Dios. Thank You for Your presence, Lord. Thank You, Lord, for Your presence. For Thou, O Lord, art high above all the earth. Let's just sing that right now. Oh, yes. Lift your hands and voices. For Thou, O Lord, art high above all the earth. Thou art exalted.
Thou art exalted far above, O God.
For Thou alone. Thou art exalted.
Thou art exalted far above, O God.
And I exalt Thee, Lord.
Glory and praise.
And I
thank you for your presence even now. That's the anointing of God just sweeping this room. Sweeping this room, flooding this place. Whatever you need this morning, you can reach out and grab a hold of it. If you came sick in your body, you can be healed right where you are. Oppression goes. Bondages go. Addictions go. Fear leaves. Oh, thank you, Lord. Romanda Daritista Pais Sombrunde Ketea Saya. So profondely si prepared an angelista. Precandely es morum brandikea. So profondely is the ketetera de diet all over. Toredasta prefatum nombre diesta. Yes, 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 yes. Yes, 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 yes. Thank you, Lord. 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 Total, total breakthroughs in every realm. In every realm. For every minister of the gospel that's here. All those, Lord, no matter what realm they find themselves in, total breakthroughs. Even this next week's going to be a supernatural week, Father. We thank you for it. We thank you. 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 Wonderful Jesus. Exalt thee, O Lord. And I exalt thee, Lord. Afraid of the Holy Ghost, because he knows if you get the Holy Ghost, he's in severe trouble. Severe trouble. Because you have access to a power that he can't stop, and he doesn't know what to do with that. He doesn't like it when you get the heavenly language, because he can't understand what you're saying. So he don't want you speaking that way. He doesn't like it if you're laying hands on the sick and casting out devils, because then he can't plunder like he wants to. And he sure doesn't like it when you get blessed, because then he can't keep you down. Man, I tell you, I feel the fire of God here right now. My God. It's good to have our miracle here with us.
Yeah. Hallelujah.
What a way to dedicate the building. He drops dead in a service. Dead. D-E-A-double-D, dead. Flatlined for 5 minutes, 4.5 minutes. I flipped him over, cursed that thing, and then we drug him out. Pastor Allen jumped on him, broke his sternum, and called him back from the dead. Yeah. He was dead. Somebody said, I'm not sure if he's dead. When there's nothing for 5 minutes, basically, you're dead. You're D-E-A-D. He would never blow a trumpet. He was that dead. But I've seen dead people blow trumpets. Anyway, I'll leave that alone. Depends on what church you go to. So people said to me, what's happening? I said, oh, just meetings, people getting touched, the dead are being raised. I mean, just, you know, kind of normal stuff. Book of Acts stuff, you know. Nothing much. So people call me, say, call this magazine. I said, they wouldn't believe it anyway. Just be quiet about it, because they don't believe anything that God's doing anyway. And then they'll say it was alleged he was dead. But he was, and he's back. Because God's not finished with him. Amen. Something happens. Something happens when we use that name. Can you say amen? Something happens.
Oh, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus.
Something happened.
Something happened when I call
you. The name of Jesus.
Jesus, Jesus, Jesus.
The most powerful name.
Jesus, Jesus, Jesus.
Oh, something happened.
Something happened.
One more. You can join in with me. Hallelujah. Oh, you've made me fruitful. El Shaddai, you bless me so exceedingly. You kept your promises, Father, and you've been a good God to me. El Shaddai, you're everything that I need.
you smooth out the rough, 'cause you're more than enough, and you've been a good God to me.
Almighty Father, El Shaddai, you pour your life into me.
Nourishment,
provider, strength giver, satisfier,
Hallelujah. I want you to go out of your way to greet two or three people and tell them you love them. Jesus loves them. Welcome to the morning. The main event here, thank you, orchestra, band, singers, epic. Hallelujah. Say this on me, the Lord is good, and His mercy endures forever. I want to greet all the Floridians that braved the big storm that's out there. People don't know this, but if you come from another state, if there's rain or winds, people think it's the end of the world here. Because it's normally sunny Florida. And there's wind advisory warnings and the ocean, and I mean, just everything. So it's just a normal, blustery February day in Florida. But those that braved through the mighty winds to get you, we salute you today. God's going to touch you in a special way. And somebody said, well, why would people not come? They don't want to lose their toupee. Many people in Florida have lost their hair to another county. And so it's a joke. If you're watching by way of television, already calls are coming in. Smithfield, Georgia, calling in for prayer. This person actually gave their life to the Lord, got joy, got baptized in the Holy Ghost. This Sefner, Florida. Sefner, that's a long way away. I mean, you could get in your car and come 5 minutes and be here. And this one's from Canada, calling in, needing a touch from God, feeling totally discouraged. This is from Canada, praying for somebody in the hospital. Here's another one from Georgia, prayer, needing deliverance. And this one's from Arkansas, needing boldness. And many calls come. Another one from Canada, many Canadians. We greet all of our Canadian friends. We love you. We're praying for you up there in the north. So call the number, people standing by to pray with you and for you. And we're going to be praying over those requests before we go off the air today. Well, what 3 weeks this has been. Two meetings a day, and then Friday night, the all-night prayer meeting, 6:30 to 6:30. And I moved all around. I was sitting in the balcony, I was sitting there, and I was at the back, and I just moved around. There's not a bad seat in the house, really. So I'm telling you, so don't fall asleep here on the balcony, because I'll come get you. Especially you in the front row here. You got a front row seat. Don't fall asleep. We'll replace you with people that are awake. Amen. At least you can't fall off the balcony. Amen. So is everybody excited? We're going to go fourth week. So every morning, 9:30, every night, 7 o'clock through Friday night, is going to be amazing. And just bring your friends, bring your enemies, bring your in-laws, bring your in-laws, bring your outlaws, bring even those that have broken all the laws, bring them all. Amen. Then next Saturday is our big car show. So we have it, the whole pavilion is going to be supercars. If you love cars, you want to hang out, or bring people that don't come to church. We've had over 2,400 people saved at the car shows already, and it's just phenomenal. And I believe we have a little clip that we can play about the car show. So roll that if you would, please. So you'll be surprised how many people are coming and getting saved that would never come to church, but they love cars. And I didn't know how many ladies love cars. I thought it was only the ladies are crazy about cars. So if you're a single guy, yeah, I'm just going to give you a little information. I'm serious. This is from your pastor. Get a nice car. No. So just... Then after the service today, Studio B Experience is feeding on the field. There'll be meals for sale there. Creamy chicken crepinas, I hope I pronounce it right, with dill sauce, crisp black currant berry cake, and a drink included. So that's going to be happening. You'll be able to eat right afterwards. And don't forget Operation Eden with all the fresh food, vegetables, and there's even some snacks and stuff that they make available from Operation Eden. Then how many of you know what's going to be happening next, well, this is February now, March. I've got to remind myself. How many of you know that we've got the big ladies' conference coming up? And the host of the conference, let me just say something about the host. I can't say enough about her. I've known this lady for a long, long time. And... I mean, maybe I'll just come up with the truth. I've been sleeping with her. I'm gonna spill the beans. Sorry, it's my wife. Sorry. I thought I'd just tell you that. But I've known her for a long, long time. It's gonna be a great ladies' conference. It's gonna be awesome, and you're gonna be blessed. Roll the clip for the ladies' conference.
When you carry that river of living water on the inside of you, you bring an oasis wherever you go. He will cause you and everything in your life to blossom. And if you'll just trust him, he can use you way beyond what you can imagine. God's plan for us is to flourish in every area of our life, our spirit, soul, and our body, personally, marriage, family, business. You're going to flourish like the palm tree, you're going to grow like the cedar, and you're going to carry that oasis where whoever you meet, if you go preach in a church, if you just meet someone on the street, you're carrying that oasis. You bring that refreshing, you bring that life everywhere that you go. You become the oasis.
If you want to have a new wife, guys, send your wife to the conference. It's going to be awesome. Except your lady's going to get on fire, and then you're going to have to be on fire too, because that's just the way it is. Amen. Well, how many want to hear what the Lord's been doing this last week in Tampa? Pastor Jason is coming. We've got a lot of testimonies of what the Lord's been doing. People have been winning souls, and people have been healed and delivered, set free, and Pastor Jason.
Hallelujah. What a mighty God we serve. Amen. This has been awesome. The interns actually 1,277 decisions for Jesus Christ last week. I thought that was awesome. Last week, 2,467 decisions for Jesus Christ. And our global soul count, 44,278,813 decisions for Jesus Christ. This is awesome testimony. We've been in the prisons. Powerful things happening in the prisons, the nursing homes. Miss Beatrice, you went to the prison. Tell us what happened.
Yes, my name is Beatrice, and a student, an intern. We had the opportunity to go to the prison, and we ministered to the ladies, and the power of God hit the place. And we had 17 in attendance, and we had 16 salvation, and we had we had 12 baptized with the Holy Spirit, and two filled with joy. This ministry is very, very powerful. We want to thank Pastor Rodney and Pastor Adonica for giving us this opportunity to go to the prison. When we go there, the ladies are so hungry that they can't even wait for us, you know, to sit, prepare the place for them to come and hear the word of God. And when the word of God was preached, it was very, very powerful that they were so filled with joy. And when we left there, we had testimonies. One of the ladies gave us a testimony that she will come to the Bible school because she was touched so much by one of the testimonies which was given. And we don't even know what we are impacting into those ladies, because last week, one of the ladies who goes to the prison met with one of them and said, did you used to come to the prison and minister to us? And she said, yes. And she said, you don't even know what you did to us, the blessings you poured into us. Now I'm attending church. Amen. 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 Thank you.
Great job. Come on, give God some praise. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Let me find my paper here. Hallelujah. Now, this is Miss Lisa. You're from Texas. You attended the healing school. And our next healing school is going to be March the 6th through the 17th. So if you're here in this great sanctuary, or maybe you're watching on one of our streams, it's free to attend. Powerful miracles breaking out. But you got to go to revival.com and register. Let us know that you're coming. Hallelujah. So tell the people what happened as a result of attending the healing school.
Well, 25 years ago, I was healed from a brain tumor, but the brain tumor actually destroyed my thyroid glands. I had what is called Hashimoto's thyroiditis. My entire thyroid was covered with tumors, so to the point that they could not biopsy it. They were going to have to remove it. The surgery was actually scheduled when I returned home from healing school on the 21st. Praise the Lord. I've canceled the surgery. I went into the one-on-one. Yeah. God is good. I went into the one-on-one and had hands laid on me, and it left. It was gone. My neck was so swollen. It just felt like it just had a constant fullness in it. And I told my doctor that I was coming here to healing school and that God was going to heal me. So I set the expectation. I put the demand out there, and praise God, I'm healed.
Come on, healed by the power of God. Hallelujah. Thank you so much, Miss Lisa. Miss Egla, you had a crusade. It's powerful how everyone's empowered to do crusades and lay hands on the sick, cast out devils, and you had a crusade. Tell the people what happened.
Yes. Good morning, everyone. How many of you know that we serve a mighty God of miracles? Hallelujah. So on the cold day of January 14th, we had a crusade. As an intern, we have an opportunity to go out and reach the lost at any cost. So as the word right here says, that we know that, but ye shall receive power, that the Holy Ghost is come upon you, and ye shall be witness unto me both in Jerusalem and in all Judea and in Samaria and unto the uttermost part of earth, according to Acts 1:8. Well, we all start in our neighborhood, in our streets, and the Holy Ghost showed the location where to be. It's right off Kingsways Road. There is a mobile home of Oak Plantation, and on that cold day, 46 attendees came. We have 46 people, and the total of altar call, we have 20 to receive Jesus, and we had 14 on the street, so the total salvations were 34 out of 46. Glory to God. We had seven Holy Ghost baptisms and power, and we had one healing. And what awesome was that never step away from the promptings of the Holy Ghost. When He compels, be so obedient immediately. I did not just go with the ones that were at the altar call. The Holy Ghost highlighted the other people in the crowd. Not too many were left sitting, but they said, go to this and go to that. There was a little girl, a four-year-old with a mom, that it was so precious to see our little ones just raising hands and saying, Jesus, I believe that you are baptized of the Holy Ghost and power. And the mom started praying in the Holy Ghost. And there was another gentleman, Jim, new. You are totally new. If you're here today, we welcome you. And him and his wife actually came to the church on Tuesday, last Tuesday. So this is the fruit of the Lord's work. Hallelujah. And so Jim was sitting there aside, and the Holy Ghost highlighted for me to go to him. And the minute I walked and I asked him, I said, you know, have you received Holy Ghost and power and evidence of speaking the other tongues? He goes, no. And he goes, something is truly special happening here. And he started weeping. And then I said, would you like to receive? He goes, I don't think I'm serving the Lord like I should. And he raised his hands. And after I said, filled, he started praying in the Holy Ghost. The power hit him. He is on fire. I said, Jim, you're not retiring. The Lord is empowering you still. He has so much on the plate for you. So, and look at the fruit. Look what the Lord has done. So with all that being said, oh, hallelujah. So the crusade, when we go after the lost, the Lord goes after our family. My mom is 86. She's all the way in Lithuania. For all those over 5 years since I've known the River Church, been saved, I was compelling her, but speaking in kindness, in patience, not just John 3:16, but like how the conversation, the Holy Ghost will navigate. And on Christmas Day, she asked me a question. And that question led for me to say, Mama, wait a minute. And I ran and I got the Lithuanian script that the other friend of mine, Jovita, was testifying about her dad last Sunday. And I read the script and she received Jesus. So hallelujah. Woo! So do not give up on your family. Love them. Speak to them. Do not give up. Do not grow weary in the well-doing. For the Lord will reward you, and your family is coming. It's coming in Jesus' mighty name.
Yeah, one other thing. I see you here. You got an apron on. Oh. So you better explain to the people why you're wearing an apron.
Yes, sir. We are running two kitchens, upstairs and downstairs.
So you're part of the Culinary Institute, yeah?
Yes, sir. I'm finishing the internship in Culinary Institute. And today I'm serving in downstairs kitchen. And we're having Lithuanian cuisine, so everybody's welcome.
So you cooked the meal for today?
Yes, sir.
So you can Glory go and experience God. That, yeah. So yeah. That's why she's got an apron.
Yes, that's yeah. why I have a uniform on, sir. Yes, thank you for the opportunity.
Come on, give God some praise. Hallelujah. Man, I feel the fire of God here. Glory to God. Jesus. Woo. Hallelujah.
What's happening? What's happening? Tell the people what's happening. That is, you said you feel the fire of God. Tell them what's happening.
If you don't feel His fire, like Pastor says, your wood is all wet. Glory to God. His fire is here. Come on, receive that power. Receive the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. I'm telling you, whatever you need here, reach out and receive. Hallelujah. If you need a healing in your body right now, hallelujah. If you need some joy, hallelujah, whatever you need. You need provision, reach out and receive it. Hallelujah. This is off the chain, man. This church is on fire.
He's trying to stay with the format to get the test series done, but the power of God's all over him, and he doesn't know what to do with himself.
Telling you, I'm being blessed here. Hallelujah. Miss Rita, this was an awesome testimony. Who's believing God for financial provision? Hallelujah. Tell the people what the Lord did for your family.
All right, I have three small testimonies, if that's okay. First one, we came to this church almost 3 years ago. I went to healing school with Pastor Ryan, and I haven't had to take blood thinners or heart pills since then. So the Lord hailed that, number one. And we're students. Thank you, Pastor Rodney and Pastor Adonica, for our scholarships. The second thing, we lost my grandson, Tommy, back in September. And this church has been so supportive, and the love they showed to our family and us, it's been unbelievable. This church is by far the best church I've ever been in. We've been saved 47 years, so it's not new to us. This is the best place. Wow. And my last testimony is, my husband and I, he retired 5 years ago, and then we refired. But anyhow, with his retirement, of course, we took a big cut in pay from $3,000 a week to $3,000 a month. So we've been tithing and offerings like we've always done. But this year, we got our statement back last week, and he came to me and he said, look at this. And I'm like, what? We gave over $28,000 to this church this year. We don't know where it came from because we usually give about $8,000 since he's been retired. Wow. The other part of it is...
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
So you have no clue where it came from?
No, it's like, how did we give this amount? Plus, we got to sponsor three students.
You guys sponsored three students?
We sponsored three students. And I was able to buy my husband one of the watches for our anniversary. We don't know where it came from. That is so good. It's been amazing. This church, the Lord has just blessed us beyond measure. And these two right here, I have to give them, they have been so supportive to my husband and myself, Pastor Derek and Pastor Cheryl. We love them to death.
Let me ask you a question. So what would you say to the other retirees here?
Don't retire, refire.
So, don't you think that the devil's trying to write off seniors and just make them do nothing? But yeah, looks like you people are getting ready for something.
Yeah, we're excited. We're going to be, he's 70, I'm going to be 70.
Oh, you're still young.
Oh, yeah. We're still going to serve the Lord till we close our eyes. So, yesterday was Tommy's birthday, and we got to celebrate with the whole family. So, it was bittersweet, but we're hanging in there. So he was going to read a scripture. That's okay.
Sure. That was scripture we've been standing on, Psalms 34. It says, the young lions lack food and suffer hunger, but they who seek, inquire, and require the Lord by the right of their need and on the authority of his word, none of them shall lack any beneficial thing. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Come on, give God some praise. Hallelujah.
If you're watching by way of television, this is called joy. The early church had it. Many in the modern church lost it. And some people think it's only for Christmas. But it's not. Somebody said, yeah, but you don't have to have so much. Why not? Just overdose on joy. People have OD'd on everything except the power of God and the joy of the Lord. And people say, you mean now in the service? Well, when do you want to get it? Later? Trying to leave some for the guests. I mean, you guys are full-time pastors yet. I mean, don't get everything. You leave it for the visitors too, you know. It's not fair that they come here and you people are drinking this new wine like that. Not another service of joy. The kingdom of God is not meat and drink, but righteousness and peace. And joy in the Holy Ghost. Just lift your hands where you are. Take a few moments. The psalmist said, you anoint my head with oil. My cup runs over. Today, he anoints your head with oil, and your cup runs over. Supernatural strength is flooding you right now. Because the joy of the Lord is your strength. Supernatural strength. Supernatural strength is flooding you right now. You will not die prematurely. You will not fail. The Lord is with you. And he's with you strong. Regardless of what's coming against you, the enemy cannot stop you. No matter what you're facing this next week, I don't care who phones, who calls, I don't care what letters arrive, I don't care what emails arrive. Woo! Right now, people are being healed in their bodies. Right now, right now, in your body, you're being quickened by the hand of God. Let Jesus come and wrap his arms around you. Let Jesus come and wrap his arms around you. It's impossible to pray for the fire to fall and then you get mad because the fire falls. What's happening here is not a move of man. If you think it's a move of man, get a crowd together and see how you do. What's happening right now is the glory of God is sweeping this room. God is touching individuals, young and old, from every background, and he's filling them with his very presence. You don't have to do anything to get it. You just have to open your heart. You can't earn it. You can't buy it. It's free. The power of God's falling in people's homes right now, wherever you might be. Remember what the scripture declares. Eat the fat and drink the sweet. And send portions to those that have nothing. That's what we're doing right here, right now. We're eating the fat. Sorry, everybody. We're eating fat. And we're drinking the sweet. And we're sending portions by way of television into people's homes that have nothing. if you're watching, this is what sustained this church through 2020, 2021, 2022, and into 2023. We've been sustained by the hand of the Lord. The World Health Organization just announced the arrival of the H5N1 bird flu virus. It's an H5N1. Do I have a message for them? If the H1N1 couldn't handle it, the H5N1 will be blown to smithereens by the fire of the Holy Ghost. Somebody said, Pastor, why are they announcing another one? Because if you keep the problem going, you can keep the money flowing. We honored to have the 5-time Grand Chief of the Cree Nation of Quebec and First Nations President with his wife, who's just flopping around at the front row here. It's so great to have them all the way from Canada. She is receiving right now on behalf of the whole of Canada. I want to read a passage of scripture before we give you an opportunity to sow seed this morning, bring your tithes and offerings to the Lord. And it's from the book of Ecclesiastes, chapter 11. And I'm going to read it from the Amplified Version. So if it comes across a little loud, it's because it's amplified. Amen. One of the things the Lord directed us to do was to teach principles of sowing and reaping, so that God's people could walk in the blessing of that. And there are many churches don't even talk about it. They just have a box at the door and they're embarrassed to speak about it. But that's what they talk about all the time when they're not in the service. They talk about money. We talk about souls. And we talk about money publicly because everybody should be involved in God's economy. Look at that testimony today. What a miracle. Retired. And they normally would give $7,000 a year, and they gave $28,000. Don't even know how they did it. Sound like they're walking in blessing. So somebody said, well, I'm retired. I'm on a fixed income. Well, who fixed it? Because you can live off your giving. So he says, you cast your bread on the waters, for you'll find it after many days. Give a portion to seven, yes, and even divide it to eight, for you know not what evil may come upon the earth. If the clouds are full of rain, they empty themselves upon the earth. If a tree falls towards the south or towards the north, in the place where the tree falls, there it will lie. And then I love this verse because this has meant so much to me over the years. He who observes the wind and waits for all conditions to be favorable will not sow, and he who regards the clouds will not reap. So when you talk to a lot of people, and even people that have wealth, because I talk to everybody from rich to poor, and people say, I would be able to give more, but everything's kind of tied up right now. Are you with me? Or somebody said, if you'd have just got me 5 weeks ago, I was able to give, but not right now. I can't. But he says here, he who observes the wind waits for all conditions of favor will not sow. And we've taught people around this church, if it's not enough to meet your need, then it must be seed. Are you with me? So let's say you have a need of $3,000 and you only got $300. Well, how's that $300 going to meet the need? It's impossible. So then plant it. And we tell everybody, of course, you pay your bills. Very important that you pay your bills. And it's very important that you work. Because if you don't work, you're not going to eat. That's just how it goes. So he observes the wind, waits for all conditions to be favorable, will not sow. And then he who regards the clouds will not reap. So in other words, the same conditions that stop you from sowing will be the same conditions that stop you from reaping. Because the blessing comes at a time when you may say, Pastor, it's not the right time for this blessing to come. It's going to overload me. But don't moan about your harvest. Hello? Don't moan because the blessing's coming now. Somebody said, do you know how much I had to pay in taxes? Oh, well, what does that mean? That means you were blessed more than you've ever been blessed before. Just go ahead and pay your taxes, give to Caesar what is Caesar's, and then give to God what's God. And don't moan. Be happy. Somebody said, well, I'll tell you what, the business exploded. I don't know what to do. We've had to hire another 20 people. What? What are you talking about? What you talking about, Willis? Seriously? That means the increase has come and there's been blessing. That's why I tell people you got to let the Lord work in you to build in you a greater capacity to receive what he wants to give you and what he wants to do through you. How many would say with the uplift hand, Pastor, just in the last 5 years, but especially the last 3 years through the COVID nonsense, 2020, 2021, 2022, that you would say that you are believing God for more than you've ever believed before, and you have stepped out in faith for more than you've ever stepped out before, and you've stretched yourself out more than you've ever stretched out yourself before. So much so that I'll tell you right now, there are friends and family probably that don't even recognize you right now. They go, who are you and what did you do with my child? Because you step in another dimension. And this is only the beginning. This year of 23 will be known the year of El Shaddai, the God that's more than enough. And you will see his hand. And there's going to be, even it's already started, an acceleration of what God is doing in your life, in your home, in your marriage, in your children, in your grandchildren, in your business, in your ministry. All those in business, wave your hand at me right now. Wave your hand at me right now. A multiplication and an increase in your business. That everything you touch multiplies. And with it is going to bring all the other stuff. But God's going to give you the wisdom, which we prayed for Friday night. God's going to give you the wisdom and give you the strategy of how to handle that properly. Because when we're faithful with a little, we become ruler over much. So let me just see all the business people. Just stand quickly. All those in business, stand. All those in business, stand. And if you want to have a business, God will even give you one. So no matter what business that you find yourself in, people say, well, you know, we listen to the... to what the media said about the economy and the gas price. God don't care. God's not worried about the gas price. God owns all the oil and everything. And just so you know, oil is not a fossil fuel. The earth produces oil every 4 to 6 years. The oil's not come from a dinosaur bones. There is no shortage of anything. It's just in the hands of the wrong people. But it shall come into the hands of the righteous. It shall come into the hands of the righteous. Amen. You may be seated. So he says here, as you know not what is the way of the wind. Like we've got wind blowing at you. We could go and you could say, Pastor, the wind's coming from the south. But when you measure it again, it's coming from the east. Then you look again, it's coming from, it swirls. You don't really know. I mean, overall now, because we have satellite imagery, we can see which way the wind's going. But when wind's moving, it swirls. It just moves. And really, that's a person in the Holy Ghost. You can't, a person flowing by the Holy Ghost, you never know what they're going to do. You can say, I think they're going to do this, and then they do this. The Spirit bloweth where it listeth, so is everyone that's born of the Spirit of God. And that's why people in religious sectors, they don't even know how to take you. Well, I tell you, I don't understand those people. Well, you're never going to understand them until you get the Holy Ghost. So he says, you know not what is the way of the wind or how the Spirit comes to bones in a woman that is pregnant. Even so, you know not the work of God who does all. In the morning, sow your seed. In the evening, withhold not your hand, because you don't know which one's going to be good, whether which one shall prosper, whether both alike will be good. You don't know. So you just, all you do, all your job is to do is just to keep giving. Serving God, being faithful, and just keep sowing. And do it with joy. And then watch what God does in your life. An increase. And I want to say this because we've got a lot of newcomers that have come after 2020, but we've taught these principles for years, and some people got mad because they went to church and they said, Pastor Rodney took 40 minutes taking the offering. And we didn't. I taught for that time, but we did. To take the offering is a few minutes. Have you seen me take anything? Yeah? No, I haven't taken anything. I'm just teaching. But I really believe that the word of all the years, this church has been going now 26 years, but the word that's been put in the hearts of people, that when all the nonsense hit, one of the greatest signs to me was, because we never had an emergency meeting as apostle staff, or the, you know, we had 70 full-time staff. We have 152 now with all the contractors included. So that means you can see how it's exploded, 70, 152. I think things are growing around you a little bit. Just a little, just a tad. Yeah. So I prayed about it. Of course, we had to broadcast from the house because of all the death threats. We had 100,000 death threats against the ministry, really targeting me. But so I had to lock the thing down, not because of a virus, but because of idiots that wanted, we're going to come, we're going to kill you. We will kill you. And kill your church. I said, why? Because you're killing everybody. Okay, let me think about this. So you're going to kill me? Anyway, just totally insanity. How many remember the time of the insane asylum? So we have 110 groups that were across the city, through the inner city, and we've been helping many people. We've been feeding. We've been feeding 1,000 families a week. And we've targeted the inner city all the years of this church. And so, of course, that's another reason why I backfired on them, because they just thought we were a little white church in a neighborhood, and they didn't realize when they arrested me, there were people going to burn everything down. I mean, you arrested my pastor, you blinkety blank. I mean, no, because some people just got saved. You know what I mean? They don't know how to, you know what I mean? Don't you arrested my pastor. I'm coming after you. So I had to tell everybody, calm down, leave the sheriff alone. He didn't know what he was doing. You know, he's my friend, you know, that kind of stuff. But people were not happy, you know. So, but I told our finance office, get $50,000 in cash and get it to the pastors. And the first 2 weeks, call every, in 110 homes. And then we even started going beyond. We called every member on the phone. Pastor Ronnie said, please call. Do you have any needs and finance or whatever? So we dispersed the $50,000. The second two-week period of time, I thought we had dispersed that. So the third two-week period, I called them and said, listen, we need another $50,000. And the pastors came back and said, no, we don't. I said, what do you mean? They said, we still have $18,000. We don't have a place. We can't give it to anybody. We call people. They go, no, we don't. Do you need? We bring money to the church. Everybody was being blessed. New houses, new cars, new jobs, everything. And God sustained this church in one of the most remarkable ways that I think I've ever seen. I was just sitting with my mouth open, shocked. And the Lord said, it's because all the years that you were putting the word in them, that when the crisis came, they stood. They stood because the word that God had given me for the whole church was, tell the church that the jar of meal will not fail and the oil will not run dry. And that's the only word that I had. Just tell them that. And it did not. Everything exploded. Everything blew up in a good way. And people were getting new jobs. And I mean, we can just think of all the testimonies of, there were things that I thought people were making up just to encourage me, but it wasn't. I said, how did that happen? Pastor, we walked in and God gave us favor. We got this property. We bought that house. We got promoted because people were committed just to obeying the word of the Lord, doing what God said. And they went covered in with God. They're tithers, they're givers, they're sowers of seed. And then God's the one that watches over his people to take care of them. So my heart breaks. My heart breaks for many churches that shut down, for many churches that don't teach these truths. The congregation is scattered. And because they made their church a non-essential service, the people felt the church wasn't a non-essential service, or that it was a non-essential service. So now that the church is open, nobody wants to go back. Why do we need to go back? We don't need to go back. And then you look at other states that are still locking down, still with masks, still vaccines, fifth boosters now, and many different things. And here we are in Florida, blessed of the Lord. So I really want to encourage you today. God doesn't lie. His word doesn't lie. And he watches over his word to perform it. So let me just prophesy to you about this next week, okay? Are you ready for this? This next week is going to be a supernatural week of blessing. A supernatural week of increase. A supernatural week of open doors. A supernatural week of provision. Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, and Saturday. Yeah. A supernatural week. Somebody said, well, I'm believing God for a car. Then you come into the car show on Saturday so you can see which one you're going to buy. And release your faith. Can you say amen? I'm not sure now. We've given away, what, 44 cars in the last 3 years? 44 vehicles that we've given away. Yeah. And we probably do some more, yeah. So maybe, I know we're going to do something at the ladies' conference. We're going to give away a vehicle at that conference. But I think we need to do something between now and then. What do you think? And people ask me, do you have the cars to get? No, I pray the bin. I pray the bin that people send cars and give this one away. Some of the things I give away I don't have, but I pray them in. So, look, if there's no response, I won't even pray in a vehicle. But all right, you've twisted my arm. So we believe God. And then there's many things people believe in God for, a new home, place to stay, accommodations, or land or property. I'm really believing the Lord that God's going to put, listen, that the Lord's going to put land in your hand. I'm talking about acreage. Who would love to get extra, like land? I know this looks like we're going to be the largest landowners in Central Florida. Oh, yeah. Somebody, who owns it? River Church people. River Church. Do you know, they used to criticize us and call us the happy church, you know, the laughing church. Do you know that they are now saying we are the wealthy, the rich church? Yeah. But let me just say this. So we could be in a place where we think we've arrived now, but we are not like the Laodicean church, who even say we're rich, increased with goods, and they've needed nothing. We need him more now than we needed him 26 years ago, and we are more dependent upon him now. And in actual fact, as you get blessed, because the Lord told me to believe him to raise up 300 millionaires in this church, and I'm not sure if they showed up here today. That we have to pray more when the provision is in our hand than when we didn't have it. Because when you don't have it, you're just praying to survive. You're just waiting for a hamburger. But when you have it, if you're not careful, you end up doing what God doesn't want you to do. So that's why we tell you, pray and ask God, Lord, what do you want done? Not what I want done with these resources. What do you want done? Amen. And of course, he'll bless you to where you think you died and went to heaven. So, hallelujah. The Lord is good. Let's pray. Ask God what he would have you do here this morning, you that are watching. We have taken a little break here before we start building again. But the next phase, this last phase, we did in 5.5 months, 11.6 million, paid cash for everything, paid it. And now the next phase is 12 million. We believe in God to do that in the latest 12 months, but really the next 9 months, which would be really great if we can do that. So all that has to come in through God's people. Can you say amen? So let's just pray, ask God what he'd have you do. Maybe there's people visiting today. You can do something you've never done before, do something substantial. Somebody said, what do you mean? Well, to build a $12 million facility, and that's just the next phase. The other phase after that is added. Just in what we're going to be adding here is about another 42 million. And we're not borrowing money from the bank. We're not going to outside sources. It's all through God's people being increased and multiplying. Can you say amen? And you that are watching by television, we around the world right now on our own network and then on the Dish and Direct platforms right now, and people watching on all the streams, ask the Lord, say, Lord, what do you want me to do to be a part of what's taking place at the river? And then the good thing is you can fly in here and come see the results of the sowing of the seed. Amen. Also, let me just say this. While you're praying, we're getting ready in two different fronts. We're about to go to Ghana inside of a month, and it's a three-day meeting. On the ground, myself and the team fly straight in. We land, we've got 3 days, 6 services, and then we come home. The calls are already coming from Africa, please come here, please come here. We can't, because otherwise we'd never get out of Africa. So we're going in, mission Ghana, coming out. If you want to sow to that, there's a drop-down box, you can do that. And then also, how many know that we helped with the hurricanes and $2 million south, all food and everything? Okay, now we are working on Turkey and we have teams on the ground. We're about to send 6 people right here from the church into Turkey, into the theater of operation to be part of the relief work. And so you can pray. There's a drop-down box where it says Turkey earthquake and you can be a part of that, or the Ghana crusade, whatever you feel God wants you to do, or the building or anything, or just into the general fund, because then we're able to use it to run whatever needs to happen here. Amen. So let's pray. Father, I pray that you bless the gift and the giver. Multiply the seed sown today. Thank you for your abundant blessings that you bestowed upon your people. Lord, we don't even know how to even, in the English language or Spanish or whatever language we speak, we don't know how to thank you enough. If we look back at the past 3 years and see your grace upon your people, that you have literally blown us away in what you have done. And I'm asking you, even now in this 23-year period, as you told me that this would be the year of El Shaddai, the God that's more than enough, the all-sufficient one, the God of plenty, that, Lord, your people would see this. And I'm praying for people that even, and I hear this in my spirit, the Lord said, encourage people, because there are many even among you this day that stand on the brink of a total breakthrough in your life in your business, in your ministry, and God wants you to be encouraged that even now angels are working on your behalf to bring it in. So do not be discouraged because that which you see on paper. Be not discouraged because numbers that look at you in your bank. But rejoice and be glad, for the Lord is with you, and his hand shall sustain you. And it shall be a suddenly upon another suddenly upon another suddenly, and you shall see his hand. And even this very next week, you shall see the hand of the Lord. So rejoice today and be exceedingly glad. For the Lord is with you. Amen. Praise God. And that's what I had in my spirit. It just popped up. It's like a pop-up toaster. You're just going along and then suddenly it just pops up and then the word of the Lord comes forth. Receive that. Grab a hold of it. Who grabbed a hold of that today? So do what God tells you to do. If the ushers have come, hand out the offering envelopes, do what the Lord tells you to do. All the instruction will be on the screen. Pastor Eric's going to come give all the briefing on that. Amen. Hallelujah. I mean, if you believe in God for certain things, how would you react if the thing you were believing God for was met? Then in that spirit of joy and anticipation, go ahead and sow. Pastor Eric.
Hallelujah. For those watching around the world, many different ways to sow seed. One is through your cell phone. You can do it right through PushPay or text message given, text 77977-GIVE-RIVER. Right through your cell phone. You can do that. All the instructions will come on whichever way you're watching. For those that are here.
Here's a testimony just come in from Indiana. A lady watching says she could not move her shoulder. As she was watching the service, she raised her hand in prayer, and she realized her shoulder was completely healed.
Hallelujah. Wow. And then through Cash App, $Revival Ministries, right through your cell phone. Of course, put your first name, last name, your business name, your ministry name right there. Also, for those watching around the world, revival.com. Go to revival.com, click invest now, or you'll see the direct link on the screen says revival.com/giving. It's another way to sow seed, revival.com/PayPal, another way to sow seed. Also, if you're watching live on Rodney Howard Brown YouTube channel, there's Super Chat. Live on Rodney and Adonica Howard Brown Facebook. All the directions are there. And then as you were hearing about all the different ways that you can give, on the drop-down box, there is one for Turkey earthquake, and then Ghana. Those are drop-down boxes right there. If you want to sow into that, those are on Push Pay, Text Message Given, and Revival.com. If you did do that, any different thing on, of course, the Cash App, then you need to put that in the you have to put that in the memo. Well, lots of different things. You probably should just read the instructions on the screen. That will work out better. I was just thinking that testimony.
Stop drinking and coming up to give the announcement.
I was just thinking about that lady. She had a suddenly in her arm. It was
here's
awesome.
Here's another one. This is from Greenville, Maryland, the healing in her body, pain and shortness of breath. While she was worshiping, the power of God come on her. She got joy, 100% better. Here's another one. Norwich, Ohio. Terrible knee pain and a rash. And by the end of the phone call, as she called in, she said, suddenly, she's standing on her leg. And she can do something she couldn't do. She recommitted life and got healed. Here's another one from Kentucky, calling in. 10 years of vertigo. Felt like she was bouncing, man, the handwriting, I need to give the word of knowledge here. But anyway, but she was instantly healed and all the pain left her body. She's totally healed by the power of God. It's happening. Call the number.
Hallelujah.
On the screen.
You can send a check in to Revival Ministries International, the River Church. Maybe the Lord's asking you to move some stuff around and send it in to P.O. Box 292-888, Tampa, Florida 33687. That will continually come up on the screen, all the directions. If we missed you here with an envelope, raise your hand. We'll make sure we get you one. If we missed you for some way, reason, raise your hand. We'll get you one. Hallelujah. And all the other ways to sow seed are going to continually come up on the screen. Do what the Lord's telling you to do. Hallelujah. Suddenly. Hallelujah.
I personally don't know how people make it without the anointing.
True.
I don't know how. How do people make it? How? Why are ministers nervous about the Holy Ghost? Why? Is it their reputation they're worried about? What reputation? It's only the reputation they built up of themselves in their mind. People say, well, I don't want people to think I'm crazy. I am. That's what the Apostle Paul said in 2 Corinthians 5:13. He said, if we are mad, as some say, if we be beside ourselves, mad as some say, it's unto God. And concerns him. But if we're in our right mind, it's for your benefit. The only reason I stay in my right mind is for the benefit of the people that are just staring at me.
Hold your offerings in your hand, your cell phone, computer in your house, put your hand on your TV, whatever, wherever you're at. Father, we thank you for increase, multiplication, more than enough. And we expect the suddenlies of God this week, supernatural finances, flap, 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 the ravens are coming in. Money coming from unexpected sources of supply, supernatural provision this week in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Ushers, go ahead. Receive the offer.
South, the east and west, and every place between. Come money, multiply to a lovely shade of green. Good measure pressed on, shaking, I got to run it over so I can sow good seed. To reach the greatest harvest of souls that the church has ever seen. Oh, come now, honey. I hear the flap, flap, flapping of the raven switch. Bring the silver, the gold, and everything. The windows of heaven is gonna pour you out a blessing. You won't have room to receive. And the kingdom of God will be flooded with souls, such as you believe. May look like sometimes the Lord is stretching you over the limit. But I want you to listen to what I'm saying, because this is not a gimmick. You've come too far to back up now, and I'll bring you good news. When you're sowing seed to bring a harvest of souls, there's no way you're gonna lose. Oh, yeah, the flap, flap, flapping up the rain is sweet. Bringing the silver, the gold, and everything. The rivers of heaven is gonna pour you out a blessing. You won't have room to receive. And the kingdom of God will be flooded with souls, such as you believe. There's more than enough provision to fulfill my vision. I'm on my way through a breakthrough. When I made this decision, I'm gonna sow seed no matter what, cause I know this is right. I'm seeking ways that I make it every day and night. Oh, come money, come now money. I hear the flap, flap, flapping of the raven switch, bringing the silver, the gold, and everything. The
jobs done. But you're limited to how much you can do if you are shut up front. Now I make it with unrighteous money. Watch me and you see that I'm not out there looking for money. Oh, come money, come now money. I hear the flap, flap, flapping of the raven strings, bringing the silver, the gold, and everything. When it's a feeling, it's gonna pour you out a blessing that you won't have really received. Oh, come money, come now money. I hear the flap, flap, flapping up the raven string, ring of the silver, the gold, and everything. When this affair is gonna pour you out a blessing that you won't have really received. The silver, the gold, and everything. The windows of heaven is gonna pour you out a blessing that you won't have room to receive. And the kingdom of God will be flooded with souls such as you believe. Oh, come money, come now money. I hear the flap, flap, flapping of the raven's wings, bringing the silver, the gold, and everything. The windows of heaven is gonna pour you out a blessing.
You're going, and you're weeping, and rejoicing.
Just lift your hands to heaven. Father, let every ear be anointed to hear and every heart receptive receive now your word today. We pray this now in Jesus' name. And everyone said, amen. Amen. You may be seated. I want you to go with me, if you would please, the book of Acts, chapter 3. And I'm going to read verse 19. He says, so repent, change your mind and purpose, turn around and return to God, that your sins may be erased, blotted out, wiped clean, that times of refreshing, of recovering from the effects of the heat, of reviving with fresh air may come from the presence of the Lord. Now you think about many in the church world of the last 3 years that really have succumbed to things that took them out, the effects of the heat, and that's why revival is so needed, and why revival is so important, and why we as a church keep everybody in the spirit of revival at all times. You know, when the Lord called me to the ministry, and I went in the ministry in 1980, off of the back of the touch that took place in my life when the fire came upon me, July 1979, from that moment, my whole thing was to get everybody touched by the anointing. And of course, you've heard my story, and I've taught even on the series of the anointing, the struggles that I had in the early part of my ministry, because everybody wanted me to be a certain way. And I tried to pattern myself after what they thought, and people said, you should do this, and you should do that, and you should say this, and shouldn't say that. And so I would try to comply in the sense of that whatever they said, you know, I mean, they're much older than me. I mean, I started, I was 18 years old in the ministry, so I listened to my elders, and especially those that had gone on before me, and I said, well, this is how you prepare for a meeting. I mean, they even told us that if you're getting ready for a service, don't talk to anybody. So which, you know, I had to, when I got married, I had to talk to my wife. I couldn't tell her, no, I can't talk to you. I'm getting ready for a service. And then when we had children, I couldn't say to the kids, now get out of here. Dad's getting ready for a service. I can't talk to you right now. So that didn't work. Are you with me? And I am a people person. It's fine for somebody, which I had to learn that a lot of ministers have insecurities, and actually don't like people. I didn't realize that. It was like a rude awakening to me that there were people in the ministry that were totally dysfunctional, and they actually didn't like people and didn't actually want to be around people, but God called them. I, on the other hand, I love people. So people, I think, are great. I can just sit and watch people, and it's the biggest comedy to me. I sit and just... If you want to have fun, just go sit in a shopping mall and just watch people. People are the most hysterical things on the planet. I mean, just watching them. Just not doing it. Just watch, observe. So I love people. So, I mean, obviously I try to do that. They said you must go lock yourself in the room, you know, at 2 o'clock and pray in tongues for like 5 hours and the service would be... I did that. By the time I got to the service, I was so tired I couldn't even operate it. I was like... yawning, just wishing, oh God, let the service end, and everybody else felt the same way. And the Lord had to speak to me, you know, what are you doing? I remember I read about Wigglesworth, you know, he would wake up at 4 a.m, pray in tongues for 3 hours, 4 to 5 to 6 or 7, and then he would have communion and dance around his bed. So I thought, that's it, man, that's the key. He raised the dead. I'm going to do just that. So I set my alarm, wake up at 4 a.m, pray in tongues, and I wake up at 11. Because I fell asleep. And then I thought, oh man, I'm never going to be anything in the kingdom of God. And the Lord said to me, what are you doing? I said, Wigglesworth, 4 o'clock, pray in tongues, 3 hours, have communion, dance around his bed. I said, I didn't even get to the dance around the bed story. And the Lord said to me, that's his relationship with me. What are you trying to do? And plus, he went to bed a lot earlier. You can't go to bed at 1 o'clock and wake up at 4 every day. You have to sleep. So obviously, I had to learn the hard way. Then also, in listening to the Lord on what to preach, because God would give me a message, especially when I begin to pastor, because, you know, everybody feels you must have the latest. People, you know, they feel good to have the latest revelation, you know, for Sunday morning. And really, that's not, you've got to feed the people. It's not about your latest sermon for your new book title that's going to go out. Gag me with a spoon. Who cares about that? What's going to feed the people? And then a lot of the stuff that's preached is preached at a theological level that should be preached in a seminary. That doesn't feed the sheep. The sheep are running around all hungry. They run around trying to eat food. And ministers are preaching for the giraffe. They're trying to feed the giraffe. A giraffe has a long neck and can eat the leaves up there, but the sheep can't. So the sheep are running around and they're all hungry. All of God's sheep say amen. So then I realized that ministers were under the pressure to try to out-message or revelate other preachers. So they were not preaching for the people. They would come, you've got a conference, you're going to speak, and you're going to out-revelate anybody that's there. And everybody's going to go, wow. Meanwhile, nobody understands a word of what they're saying. Even the preacher doesn't understand what he's saying. So then they would say, you're going to have to get the tape. And if you get the tape, you're going to listen to it over and over. But even when you got the tape, you listened over, you still didn't understand what he was saying. I would go to meetings and people were taking notes. And I'm sitting there going, okay, I must be somewhere wrong with me. I can't, there's no notes here. I didn't even know what to say. What is he talking about? And I would say to Donica, do you know what he's talking about? She said, no. I said, I don't either, but I guess this must be really deep. But it's so deep, we can't even grab a hold of it. Then I was raised around church. I don't have a clue what the guy's talking about. It's always like you're coming through your season. There's a shift, and you're moving into your destiny. And it was like what? Like, I thought you told me that last year when you came around, you told me the same thing. So then I began to realize that people were substituting a lot of things for the presence of God. Are you with me? Then they're going to get titles. And the more titles they get, the less anointing there is. The right honorable bishop, archbishop, apostle of apostles. You meet somebody, this is a pastor. No, he's not a pastor, he's a pastor's pastor. Oh, really? Wow. Do we have an evangelist, a pastor's evangelist, you know, to get them all saved first? I mean, all of the titles, the right honorable reverend, doctor, bishop. You didn't know which ring do I kiss? Do I fall down here? What do I do here? And all of the substitutes that are taken and put in place for the power of God. It was always come tonight, God's going to move. Well, why does he move now? Well, we're not letting him move now. Why would we let him move now? Pastors would come to me and say, listen, you can't have a move of God on Sunday morning. They said, you don't change oil on the showroom floor. I said, look, this might have been a previous showroom, but what do you mean you don't change oil on the showroom floor? If people are coming here broken, was I just kind of like candy coat everything? We're throwing out spiritual popcorn, peanuts, and candy, and we can't have the power of God. No, because if you have the power of God, then some people might get offended. Who's going to get offended? Somebody said, if we have a move of God in our church, it'll empty our church. What kind of a church are you running? A gambling casino? The only people that are going to get offended by the power of God are religious people. Sinners come in from the world. They don't know anything. They're on their way to hell. And the power of God comes like living water and just washes them clean. And the times are refreshing. Where's this been all my life? Why doesn't my church do this? What's that language they're talking? I don't know, but it sounds wonderful. How do I get access to that? So I think one of the problems has been through the years is people want to control. If you look back through the centuries, you'll see revivals, outpourings of the Spirit of God, God moving by His Spirit, but the ministers want to control it because they don't know what to do. If the people get on fire, how am I going to control them? Well, let me tell you, you're not supposed to control them. Then bring them under the Holy Ghost control and get everybody winning souls, because that's what happens when the fire of God touches you. You've got to go tell somebody. Somebody says, yeah, but they're not ready. The moment you get saved, you're ready to tell somebody about Jesus. The moment you get saved, the moment you meet Jesus, you're ready to go and run your mouth everywhere you go and shout it from the mountaintops and rooftops and tell everybody about Jesus. And you've heard me say this before. I've watched ministers bring an altar call down, and then the people are praying, and they say, now I just have to warn you, from this day now, you're going to be an open target for the devil. The devil's going to come after you. The guy's come off crack cocaine. He's been running with the gangs, but now the devil's going to come after him. Whoa, 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 whoa. What are you talking about? The devil's had him for all these years. Now Jesus came after him and set him free. What are you talking about? I've been preaching for guest speaker at the church, and the pastor wants to come younger altar full of people, and he gets up to say that, and I go, you're gonna be quiet, and then I deal with it privately in the back room. I said, what are you doing that for? I don't know. I was raised. That's what we told people. I said, how can you tell people that? Now God's got them now. The devil's going to call for a change of underwear. What are you talking about? You know, religion is a terrible thing. It's like bad breath. You don't know you have it, but everybody else knows you have it. And that's what religion is like. Repent and be converted, that your sins may be blotted out, that the times of refreshing will come. Recovering from the effects of the heat, reviving with fresh air. That's what you're going to do this week. Everywhere you go, listen, everywhere you go, you're going to tell people about Jesus. Everywhere you go, you're going to revive people with fresh air. Everywhere you go, you're going to be a breath of fresh air coming into the place. Why? Because when revival comes in you, it must flow out of you. So if you want a title, I can give it to you at the end, but I'll give it to you right here. I'm going to talk to you about revival this morning. We're going into the fourth week here. This whole week, morning and night, is going to be awesome. And I'll just tell you, I am having the greatest time of my life. I am so happy to be here. I'm so happy. These past 3 weeks have been so awesome. And then Monday morning of the second week, the glory of God flooded this place, just like it did in that first meeting in upstate New York in the month of April of 1989. And it flooded this room at 9:30 in the morning. So I'm so happy. And we dedicated this place. We dedicated with that all-night prayer meeting on Friday night. What an amazing, amazing time. So the first question that people ask, or they make a comment, but I'm asking it in the form of a question today, is revival a sovereign move of God? So that's what people, the first thing they go, it's a sovereign move of God. Okay, so if it's sovereign, then there's really nothing you can do to even have a revival. because God might sovereignly decide not to even give you one. That's a lie from the pit of hell. What do you mean, Pastor? There's a move of God that's taking place before the throne of God and has been going for eternity past. And we either plug into that move or never plug into the move. Why do people not plug into the move of God? Because of control, manipulation, the flesh, and the structures of religion and tradition that keep the move of God out of the church. Because they're afraid they're going to offend somebody. Who's going to get offended? It can only be a religious person. Why do you think we put the sign up at the front of the pavilion? Welcome to River Tampa Bay Church. Please be warned. This church is not recommended for Pharisees, Sadducees, wouldn't sees, or couldn't sees. Any long-term exposure to this church will result in excessive joy, freedom, and then we give people opportunity in case they need to leave before you get infected and affected and totally ruined. You're never going back. You'll never go back. Can you say amen? No, God sovereignly moved 2,000 years ago in a place called the Upper Room. 120 people were gathered and came together. They waited 10 days from the time Jesus ascended. And they waited and waited. And then on the morning at 9 o'clock, on that morning of the day of Pentecost, suddenly there came, they were all with one accord in one place. Suddenly there came a sound from heaven like a mighty rushing wind, filled all the house where they were sitting, and they appeared to them cloven tongues like as a fire. That outpouring of the Spirit of God came on the day of Pentecost, has never stopped even to this very moment, because God is still pouring out His Spirit upon all flesh. The Holy Ghost has been at work for 2,000 years. There's never been a time. Some say, yeah, well, there was a dark ages. Even if you go back and study history, you'll still find the move of God was taking place. There were groups of people that were moving in signs and wonders and miracles, and the power of God was being poured out. Don't let people rewrite history and tell you what's happening. People in America think that the Holy Ghost came on the day of Pentecost and disappeared for 1,900 years and showed up at 1906 at Azusa Street. Are you on crack? God was moving way before Azusa Street. What about the Welsh revival, 1904, 2 years prior? What about 1856 Welsh revival? What about the 1700s? What about the 1600s? Outpourings of the Spirit of God. You think the Holy Ghost has been dead? No. Well, just because you don't know about it and it wasn't on your television set doesn't mean you say God wasn't moving. The Holy Ghost is still the Holy Ghost, and the Holy Ghost has been moving for 2,000 years. And the Holy Ghost is still in the earth today, moving with great power. And that's why the devil thought he'd lock the church down, shut them down, put moss on them, and get them to 6 foot social distancing, and then even cut them down to 10 people. But he didn't realize there were some people that said, absolutely not. We're not bowing. We'll never bow. We'll never compromise. And I'm telling you, those are the ones that will see the explosion of what God's about to do in the earth. Hallelujah. And we are right now in the middle. This is already happening. It's not coming. We're in the middle of the greatest move of God right now that the world has ever seen. I'm telling you right now, this is it. You were handpicked by God to be a part of the greatest outpouring of the Spirit of God with signs, wonders, miracle, and the dead raised. This is our moment. This is our... I don't care what the spirit of Antichrist is doing. This is not the hour of the Antichrist. This is the hour of the body of Christ rising up in power and the anointing of the Spirit of God. Every one of you, winning souls, laying hands on the sick, casting out devils. Every one of you, from the littlest child to the oldest saint. Why? Because that's Bible. That is Bible. My grandchildren's are here this morning. Little Kennedy's over there. He is just 4 years old. He fell down the stairs about a month ago. Kennedy runs up to him, sticks her hand on his head, raises her hand. She says, "In the name of the God of my mother, be healed." A four-year-old knows what to do. The devil is not ready for what's happening. He's not ready in the nations for what's happening. Now, I'm not here talking to cessationists and all those that believe that all this passed away with the last apostle. If that's what you believe, I have nothing else to say for you. Change the channel, because this program for you has now ceased. All of those people have no scriptural grounds for any, there's nothing doctrinally to even prove what they're saying. There's over a billion people on the planet that speak in other tongues. And many people that have been healed and miracles that you cannot deny. How many in this room would say with the uplifted hand, "I received a miracle of healing in my body over my lifetime"? Wave your hand at me right now. So to all those that feel it stopped, take that and stick that up your spiritual nostril. Now, something just happened in a place called Wilmore, Kentucky, this last week at Ashbury University, which is a Wesleyan Methodist university. The chapel service started at 10 o'clock, and it's still going on right now as we speak, 24 hours around the clock. This actually happened in the 70s. Dr. R.T. Kendall was touching that, and that's how he got baptized in the Holy Ghost and spent his whole ministry amongst the Baptists and whatever, but he secretly was a tongue talker. He was undercover. I posted it, and I can show you what's happening. This is in the chapel service, and it's led by the students. This is just going 24 hours round the clock. And, of course, I've already seen the comments on social media. Did they even open a Bible? And just, like, you know. And so what I'm concerned about, I wrote a whole thing. This is what I tweeted this morning, because I thought somebody's going to try to get their grimy hands into this. Are you with me? Because that's just how they always are. They co-opt everything. Are you with me? People don't know this, but that revival that took place in Minnesota, where they were baptizing people in the streets, was actually started by an RU graduate, a River University graduate, actually went up there and started that. And other people came in and started worshiping and took the whole thing over, and everybody thinks they started. They had nothing to do with it. So what you're dealing with in the church are what we call opportunists. They have nothing in themselves. They have to parasite off the back of somebody else. Because if you had something of yourself, why do you already need a crowd, and why do you already need churches to work with you? If you had something of yourself, you could go into any place by yourself and the thing would break out. And I've seen this happen over the years. I've seen people try to book themselves in right before I'm coming. They know I'm coming to a city. 2 weeks before, they try to get into the same church and run an extended meeting. And I called the pastor and said, "I'm canceling." They said, "Why?" I said, "Because I know what they're doing. They're trying to co-opt what God's going to do, and I'm not going to be a part of this. We are not playing games here. Because I know what we carry is real. We don't carry GMO. We don't carry a genetically modified gospel that's got a little bit of this, a little bit of that, and a little bit of this, a little bit of that. And the thing that we have fought most over the 26 years of this church is to keep the river pure and to keep the stream pure." So I wrote this. I said, "A chapel service on Wednesday, 10 a.m., started in this university. It's not stopped. It's still going. Ashbury University has not commented on it. This should be happening everywhere. May this spread to every university across our nation. This happens when people get hungry for God. Many will refer to this as a sovereign move of God. However, God sovereignly moved 2,000 years ago on the day of Pentecost, and he never stopped moving and still moving today. Can't wait to hear all the critics, the controllers, or better yet, the opportunists who would love to co-opt what God has done. Let this shut down the whole university. Let the fire continue to fall and shut down all of our universities across America. And shake everything that can be shaken. So may this explode. So then people call me, are you going to go up there? I said, why would I go up there? I have one going on here. So you got all these preachers, all they do is run over here, run over there, run over there. Because they think the Holy Ghost is living somewhere. He's not. He's there. You just have to ask him to come and fill you and touch you. And he said, out of your belly will flow rivers of living water. Why is it that man always wants to build an edifice? That's why the church has gone into the new age. Because now they're talking portals and all that kind of stuff. There's a portal. Like, you've been watching too many science fiction movies. Are we going to redig the well of revival? The well's not in the ground. The river's in people. It's not in the ground. Oh, we're going back to Azusa Street to go redig a well. No, that's not how it works. You can Azusa all you want to. You better get the fire like Daddy Seymour had. Are you with me? Redig the well. You're smoking crack. What goes on in many charismatic circles is nothing more than idolatry. Yep. Yes. It's idolatry. Yep. It's the same reason television ministries send stone from Jerusalem so you can win for your gift of $1,000 this month. You get special stone and you can feel close to God. It's like if the preacher had a big belly, they could send a picture of the belly, they could rub the belly. It's like a Buddha. The Holy Ghost comes to live on the inside of you. Out of your belly will flow rivers of living water. Out of your innermost being shall flow forth rivers of living water. That river is not just to be used inside the four walls of the church, but outside on the streets. Do you know there's some people that never tell people about Jesus, but they always want to prophesy in church? They always got some kind of a tongue interpretation. You say, how many people have you led to the Lord? That's not really my ministry. Come here, let me slap you. And you want to know, that's why many revivals come to an end, because people just keep it all inside and they just, it must be outside. It's got to go out of the four walls. This is what America needs right now. You catch fire, you catch fire, you catch fire, you catch fire, and then you go, and the fire begins to spread. If one kid can drop a match and 400,000 acres of California burn, then what will one person full of the fire of God do? One man, one woman, full of the fire of God. That's why the devil thought, I'll coronavirus them into silence. I'll put a mask on them. I'll shut them down. And God said, oh, really? They thought the church was some kind of an organization that you could just officially shut down. They didn't realize the church is the body of Christ, and you can't stop the church. Amen. You can't stop the body of Christ. Hallelujah. 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 So I'm praying that God sweep that university to where they can't even have classes. And just arrest everything and then let it spread to another university, to another one, to another one, to another one. And just like that, whatever the devil was planning with our young people has been shot to pieces. Hallelujah! So people say, are you going to go? What am I going to go do there? Well, just to feel. I can feel it here. It's the Holy Ghost. Let me play the clip so you can see. Just put a clip up. Wesleyan Methodist University. So now, from what I'm hearing, many are getting baptized in the Holy Ghost and speaking of other tongues. So the devil thinks he's got this thing locked down and he's got the thing won. I got news for you. He's failed miserably because God is on the move. I've said, God is on the move. Hallelujah. Now, the thing that has to happen is once people that have an encounter with God or being refreshed or touched, they have to be mobilized for the harvest. That's how it explodes. That's why we tell everybody must go win souls. How many soul winners do we have in the room? Okay, so that this week shall be a great week of harvest. That God's going to lead you across people that desperately need to know, and you're going to tell them about Jesus. And guess what? When you take your hand to put it on them, to pray for them, the same power that you felt right in this room is going to come upon them, and God's going to shake them to the very core. And that's how it spreads. Hallelujah. One catches fire, then another one, then another one. Revival's not just a meeting. Revival is not just a meeting where we have a revival. Revival is people getting saved, healed, set free, and delivered. And the power of the enemy broken. Can you say amen? And so this is what we were even praying about this last week. That God would shake. How long have we prayed here in the all-night prayer meetings that God would shake whole universities and our schools? And we already see that here. We see more kids being saved in the high schools of Hillsborough County than any other county in America. And that's not our numbers. That's from the Student Christian Movement. Out of the top, 27 high schools? 29 high schools this county. Yeah. Just ours. This whole county is shaking under the power of God. Thousands of kids are coming to Christ. Why? Because of all of our youth that are in all of these schools and they're winning people to Jesus. I'm telling you, the devil's not going to have, he's not going to have his way. We're about to do a big outreach on the University of, USF, University of South Florida. What day is that? The 27th of March. You had to move the dates to March. Okay. So, I mean, there's going to be big, massive outreach there, but they're already winning souls, and we already got groups on campus. So this is not what the devil thinks. He thinks he's got this thing locked down, but he made a very bad career move by trying to lock everybody down and shove double masks on them. He just made a bad move because the church, well, at least the people I know said no. No, we're not doing that. We're not going to do that. So revival is not coming. It is here. What we believe in God for is the awakening that then sweeps through the town, sweeps through the streets, sweeps in the marketplace, into the places of business, into places of commerce, into government. Can you imagine what will happen if the power of God sweeps into the Congress and shuts down all those talking heads? Imagine they get up to try to speak. And if you go back and look at American history back in the first 200 years of America, they would open Congress with praise and worship. There were times the power of God would sweep through the whole thing. Nobody could even speak. That's in American history. Somebody said, oh, well, we're not sure if we can. I tell you, God will smack him so hard. I mean, Uncle Joe will be speaking in like his ramble that we never know. I mean, this last week was something about, I can't even repeat what he said. Nobody knows what he said. And I'm telling you, the power of God could get them all saved, baptized in the Holy Ghost, speak in other tongues. Can God do it one more time as he did? Yes, he can. Yes, he can. But we are not compromising. You've heard me tell you this Sunday after Sunday. The World Economic Forum has influenced many denominations here in America. The Southern Baptist Convention announced at the big national conference, I believe it was in August, in Anaheim, and said there are three things that they would target as a denomination. They would target tongues because they don't want the church speaking other tongues. So that tell you, World Economic Forum, these are Satan worshipers. Yes. They don't like tongues. Well, guess what? We like tongues, and we speak in tongues. Amen. They don't like healing and miracles. Guess what? We love healing and miracles. We're gonna see them every day. People are not coming to church to get healed. They're getting healed by the church, wherever the church goes. Amen. And then they don't like prosperity. Well, I've got news for them. Because we took everybody in this church in a vow of prosperity. We don't have a vow of poverty yet. Can you say amen? And out of this place, people will be launched to the far-flung corners of the globe, carrying the fire of God. Bible schools will be launched. New churches will spring up. These people sitting staring at me right now, God's going to use you to write history in a nation. And you might not understand that right now, but you will. Amen. At the time of launching. And God will put a fire in you and you'll be blasted out of here. Amen. Amen. Like a Holy Ghost tomahawk missile. And you'll be dropped into place. And then the supernatural will take place. So that's what this church is about. That's what revival's about. And I'm so excited that God allowed us to be alive in this year. To see what is happening. Can you say amen? Amen? And every one of you that already being used of God, you can feel it in your bones right now what I'm talking about. I can see some people have gripped onto their seats. Some people have had to put your seat belts on here as I've been preaching. There's people sitting here that are crusade evangelists, having mass crusades. There's people sitting here that have got tents that are moving around. There's ministers sitting here in this place. This is your home, and you come in here, and you get refreshed, and you go right out, and you're wreaking havoc in the camp of the enemy. And this is only the beginning. I said it's only the beginning. America will shake by the power of God. From Maine to the Keys, to San Diego, to Seattle, across the great state of Alaska, the Hawaiian chain, even the island nation of Guam, American Samoa, even to Puerto Rico, wherever the flag flies. This nation, God has not forgotten this country. And God sent me here as a missionary to America to tell America it's not over. It's not over. It's not over. It is not over. And this church was made for COVID-19. Hallelujah. Praise God. And this people were made for this moment. Praise God. How many of you feel this on the inside of you? So God's going to use you all in the different realms that you find yourself in, whether it be business, government, whatever. You're going to take that territory. Amen. And you have to have the same anointing that's on me. You have to function that, obviously, to function in your realm. You can't do this without the power of God. Amen. So listen, I want to encourage you. Seeing we're going the fourth week, some said, are you going to go after that? I don't know. I've just been doing this week by week, you know. I know by Friday, I don't know. I haven't planned anything. I'm only doing what the Lord says to do. So we could finish Friday night. That's it. It's done. And then this four-week period of time will be history. But I'm going to ask you to do whatever you can to make any adjustment, to get in as much as you can, and not only that, and bring some people, drag them here. I don't care if you've got to put chloroform, what's that thing where you, what is it? Where you knock them out? Yeah, and just bring them here. We'll get them here. We'll bring them round over here. We'll have smelling salts for them. No, bring people that desperately need a touch from God. Somebody said they'll come kicking and screaming. That's fine. Just bring them. They'll thank you in the long run. Yes, they will. They'll say, thank you so much. Thank you so much. I want everybody to bow your heads across this room, in the balconies, in the main floor. Only the workers to move right now. Please be careful. While heads are bowed and eyes are closed, and you watching in your home by way of television, I want to give a call today. If you fit in any one of these three categories, I want to pray with you and for you. Maybe you came here today and you say, Pastor, I never give my life to the Lord, but today I want to surrender my life to Jesus. As you walked in here, as you came on the property, you felt God's presence. I want you to know you can live like this. I want you to know that your house can be like this, a place filled with the very presence of God. If you're watching in your homes and you sense that anointing just flowing into your house, will you surrender your life to Jesus? What would happen if today was your last day on the earth and you breathed out your last breath? Where would you go? Where would you spend eternity? I want you to know there is a heaven to gain and a hell to shun. You don't have to go to a devil's hell, because 2,000 years ago on Calvary's cross, the price was paid, the blood was shed, and just like that old song said, there is a fountain filled with blood, drawn from Emmanuel's veins, and sinners plunged beneath that flood, lose all the guilty stain. Today, the power of sin will be broken. The power of guilt and shame will be removed from your life. You might have come in here one way, but you'll live another way. Today, he calls you. Will you surrender today and say, yes, Lord? Maybe you're here in this place, or you're watching my way of television, and you say, Pastor, I gave my life to the Lord in days gone by, but I've grown cold. I'm not serving God like I should. I've allowed the things of the world to come in. I've lost my first love. The heat has really affected me. Maybe it's something that's hidden that you've never dealt with. Pride, unforgiveness, bitterness, jealousy, anger, lust, hidden things that clog the heart of man. But today you say, I want to be free. He said, I will take out the stony heart and put in a heart of flesh. He said, a new spirit will I put within you. Today, that's what will happen. Today, he will revive you. He will revive you today, if you'll let him. He loves you. And he stands with arms wide open. He says, come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, I'm going to give you rest. Take my yoke upon you. Learn of me. My yoke is easy. My burden is light. He calls you. He says, come. Will you surrender to him today? Somebody said, well, what if it's not hidden? What if it's very outward and everybody's seen it and they know, and I feel so bad, but everybody knows about it. They've already publicized what I've done. And it doesn't matter. God's a God of a second chance and a God of a new beginning. If you'll surrender to him and say, yes, Lord, yes, I come. I surrender to you. Maybe it's not hidden or outward as we described. Maybe a storm came against your life. You were going along, serving the Lord. Many people come to me, even ministers come to me. They say, Pastor, I was on fire. I was doing well. And then this thing hit me like a Mack truck from hell. A sudden divorce, a bankruptcy, the loss of a loved one, a sudden illness, the betrayal of a close friend, the loss of a job. Something happened, rocked my world. But today, I want to come back. Today, I want to fall in love with Jesus all over again. Can he restore me? Can he renew me? Can he revive me? Can he make me live again? And the answer is yes, he can. Just surrender today and say, yes, Lord. And then maybe you here in this place, watching by way of television, and you say, Pastor, I do love the Lord, but I don't have the assurance. I don't know beyond a shadow of a doubt that I'm a child of God. I have a constant battle between my head and my heart, and the devil's always lying to me, telling me that I'm not saved. But today I want to know. I want to know beyond a shadow of a doubt. I need to know that I'm born again. I want to pray with you and for you. While heads are bowed and eyes are closed, if this is you and you fit into any one of these categories, I'm going to pray with you and for you right where you are. Quickly, without hesitating, just go ahead and put your hand up and say, pray for me. Pray right now. God bless you. God bless you. God bless you on the main floor. In the north balcony, just slip your hand up. Thank you. Just slip it up high. Another hand up there. Another hand up there. In the south balcony, just put your hand up. And on the floor, hands are going up here at the back. Slip your hand up. Another hand back over that side. Over here towards the north balcony. That's the south balcony. Over here on the front, God bless you. Up there, God bless you. On the main floor, just slip it up high and say yes. Yes, that's me. God bless you. Yes, yes. Today is your day. Today. Somebody said, I'll leave it for tomorrow. There might not be a tomorrow. Today is the day of salvation and freedom. Once you raise it, you can put it down. I want you to look at me, if you would, please. Let's start over here in the south balcony. If you're in the south balcony or on the floor on this side, if you didn't raise your hand, but you want to be included in the prayer we're going to pray right now, quickly put your hand up and say, yes, that's me. Anybody else, slip it up high and say yes. The center section and the west balcony, slip your hand up and say, include me. I see your hand, lady. Thank you. Yes. So I've seen your hand. Thank you. God bless you. Anybody else? And then the north balcony, slip your hand up. Thank you, right at the back. And then back here on the floor. I'm going to ask every person to raise your hand if you do something. Just stand to your feet right now, all across the building. Every person to raise your hand. I want you to come from where you are and come stand right there. We're going to pray together. The ushers will help you come from the balconies and bring you down. Come. Come stand right here. We're going to pray together. Come. To follow Jesus. I have decided. To follow Jesus. No turning back.
No turning back.
No turning back.
No turning back.
The cross before me, the world behind me. The cross before me. The cross before me. The world behind me. No turning back.
No turning back.
No turning back.
No turning back.
You could take the whole world, but give me Jesus. Take the whole world.
Take the whole world.
But give me Jesus.
But give me Jesus.
You can
could take the whole world. Turning back.
No turning back.
Now, let me just say this. You know, before this nonsense, every Sunday we would see 150 plus, some Sundays 300 saved because of our outreaches. We had to change all of that. And then they started targeting the church to try to bring people here to get people sick. If I told you all the stuff that went behind the scenes, that doesn't mean we're not winning souls. I mean, you saw last week, what's it, a couple of thousand people saved on the street. So everybody's winning souls. But I'm talking about our altar calls in here. And so I'm working on a whole new strategy to get my altar calls in here back up to 150 to 300 on a Sunday. And that just give me some time working on it. Amen. Because we work around what the enemy is doing. Because not only did that stop our harvest, because how many know when we ran across the country, we did 55 cities in 27 months back, 08, 09, 07, yeah. And we saw 1.1 million people saved. A half a million were saved in retirement homes. That's the thing that stopped. They wouldn't let us in retirement homes, and that's where we saw many people saved, even on their deathbeds. And so we were cut off. It's all started again. Now we can go back into prisons, go back into retirement homes. So all that's picking up momentum. It is. And then, of course, we still have such strict rules to even come to church here. Everybody has to sign a waiver, show an ID, and get a band. So one Sunday, we turned away 600 people because they just wouldn't give an ID. Somebody said, why did you do that? Because I had to protect you. Because if somebody won't show an ID, why? Then what is your purpose and why are you coming? So if anything, we have dampened whatever we were doing before to protect the congregation. But I will do whatever it takes to protect the people that come to worship here. So, I'm working on all the solutions, and you'll be hearing of them here. When the moment this thing comes to an end, this special dedication time, and then we'll be working on the way we bring in the harvest, because I like seeing the altar packed on Sunday morning. Amen. But I know that you have an altar everywhere you're going. You have an altar call, and then they get altered. Because that's the number one spelling mistake people put on. So many people came to the altar, which is A-L-T-E-R. That's not what, it's an A-L-T-A-R. But you do get altered at an altar. Amen. Yeah. Praise God. So, anybody say souls?
Souls.
Anybody say the harvest?
Harvest.
Anybody say Jesus?
Jesus.
Stretch your hand out towards these precious people. You in the homes, pray this prayer with us. As we pray with them, raise your right hand to heaven. That's where your help comes from. And pray this prayer. Believe it in your heart. Say with your mouth. Say, Father, I come to you in the precious name of your Son, Jesus. Lord, you said in your word, if I confess with my mouth, Jesus is my Lord and my Savior, and I believe in my heart that God has raised you from the dead, I will be saved. So, Father, right now, I confess Jesus is my Lord and my Savior. Come into my heart right now. Take out the stony heart. Put in a heart of flesh. Wash me, cleanse me, change me, fill me, use me. Let me never be the same again. I turn my back on the world. I turn my back on sin, and I follow you, Lord Jesus. Thank you for dying for me. Thank you for shedding your blood for me. Thank you that on the third day you rose for me. And thank you that you're coming back again for me. From this day on, I'll never be the same again. I confess Jesus Christ has come in the flesh. He is my Lord and my Savior. And right now, by faith in the finished work of the cross and by the shed blood of Jesus, I am saved. Thank you, Lord, for saving me now. Now just lift your hands and thank him right now. Just thank him right now. Just thank him right now. Now, Father, I pray that right now you would seal them by your blood and by your spirit, that on that day not one would be missing. Raise them up to be mighty men and women of God and use them to impact this generation, we pray. Let the fire of the Holy Ghost come upon each one now. In the name of Jesus, every bondage is broken, every addiction is broken. I set you free right now. In the name of Jesus. And Lord, I thank you for it. In Jesus' name, never the same again. And Lord, use every one of them to be mighty soul winners and bring in this harvest. Amen. Praise God. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Now, we give away scholarships to the university. If you would like one, we'll give one to you, too. So you can tell Pastor Shannon or Pastor Jason that. If we can just split down the middle, and you go that way with Pastor Shannon, and you go that way with Pastor Jason, just for a few minutes. Just go through this way. God bless you. Follow through this way. Ushers, if you'd help them. Come on. The Bible says all heaven rejoices over one sinner that comes to repentance. Hallelujah. So the Lord's giving us strategy, and we're working on that now. And I thank God for all the evangelists that are based out of here that are having mighty meetings, and some that are even focusing on the state of Florida. I know Evangelist Unkert just had a meeting in Ocala, which has been phenomenal. He's going to do a big one in Lakeland, yeah, coming up. When is it? In April. My granddaughter knows when the date's on. Well, thank you. Amen. So, big things. We're going to see the state of Florida shaken by the hand of God. There's not even a question about it. There's not even a question. Not even a question. It's over, basically. Tell the devil he can go to Oregon, but he's not staying here. I'm teasing. We love Oregon, too. We have great churches in Oregon. Amen. So the devil maybe have to go to California. No, he can't have California, too, because we've got great churches in California. He can't have California. Maybe go to New York. No, he can't go to New York. We've got great churches in New York. Look, why don't you just get the hell out of our country, huh? How about that? How about that? Leave our country alone. America belongs to God. Amen. Praise God. Put your hand on your belly. Some people's hands will be further away than others. Mine used to be further away, and then the Lord helped shrink me some. I got a little bit more inflation now than I had. Inflation got bad over COVID, you know. I was inflated, but I'm about to deflate some more. Amen. Put your hand on your belly. You know what started it? How many want to know what started? All the food supplies that we were supposed to have. Remember, everybody had to get food supplies, and then in the first 15 days, you ate your supply of food. You know? So that was the problem. Father, thank you for the Holy Ghost that indwells your people. In John 7 and 37, the last day, the great day of the feast, Jesus stood and cried, saying, if any man thirst, let him come unto me and drink. He that believeth on me, as the scripture said, out of his belly out of his innermost being shall flow forth rivers of living water. Let these rivers flow this week. Let these rivers flow this week. Let these rivers flow this week. Let them flood. Let them flood their business. Let them flood their workplace. Let it flood every person they come into contact with. Father, we thank you. We thank you for that. In Jesus' name. Thank you already for the joy that we've experienced in the service today. Some have only experienced it in small portions. May they experience it even in abundance. Some may be, Lord, afraid to even yield because they're afraid that someone will see them on television. But Lord, if you could ruin their reputation that they feel they have, that would be really wonderful today. Ruin everyone's perceived reputation. As John said, I must decrease, he must increase. And I thank you for that now, in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. I want the ushers to come hand out the communion. This is what we've done as a church. This is how we've kept everybody safe, through the bread and the cup. This one came in from Columbia, Missouri. This call came in right after midday. It says, I had a birth defect in the spine that got totally healed, no more pain. She was able to bend and jump up and down, felt the fire of God throughout her spine. She recommitted her life and got healed. Miracles are happening. That's why we secured the satellite time to cover the globe. They're watching us on Hong Kong cable right now. They're watching us in Moscow, former Soviet Union. They're watching us right now in the Middle East. We're into tens of millions of homes in the Middle East. They're watching us across North America. They're watching us into the islands of the sea. Some testimonies that we won't even hear till we get to heaven. I'll wait for everybody to get communion, and then we'll take it together. One of the things that concerned me was I said to the Lord back, this was years ago, I said, how do I keep the congregation safe from all of the stuff that they're doing? The water's polluted, the food's polluted, the air is polluted. And he said, my table. And this is how we kind of close things on Sunday mornings with the communion. How many would say that this has been the lifesaver for many, many people? Yes, it has. And I thought it was interesting that the WHO said that we could not do communion anymore. How many remember they said that? I said, who do the WHO think they are? So Isaiah 53, 4 and 5, surely hath borne our grief and carried our sorrows. Yet we did esteem him stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and with his stripes were he healed. Matthew 8, 17, that it might be fulfilled, which was spoken by the prophet Isaiah, saying himself took our infirmities and bare our sicknesses. 1 Peter 2, 24, who his own self bare our sins in his own body in the tree, that we being dead to sins should live unto righteousness, by whose stripes we were healed. Father, right now we hold in our hand this bread that represents the body that was broken and bruised and torn for us. We also know that we cannot receive forgiveness if we do not forgive others. So right now, Father, everyone in this room releases any person that's ever hurt them. We hold no ill will towards them. We don't even pray for their demise, and we don't even ask for you to kill them. Now, I have to reiterate that, Lord, because you know some of your children have not been praying right prayers. Some of your children have been praying mean prayers and asking you to kill other people, and you don't do that. So we're asking for you to save them and heal them. And we forgive every person that's ever harmed us. And because of that, we can receive full forgiveness. And we hold this bread that your word says, by the stripes of Jesus, we be healed. And as this bread is put in their mouth, let there be a quickening down to right to the cellular level, into the marrow of their bones, their hearts, their lungs, their circulatory system. Whatever is being pumped at them through the food, the air, the water shall have no effect upon their life, but by your mighty hand they shall be sustained. And we thank you for that now. And we receive this by faith in the finished work of Calvary. Thank you, Lord. And now this cup, the blood that was shed, the blood that washes us clean, the blood that not only washes us clean, the blood that keeps us pure, the blood that keeps us holy, the blood that seals us unto the day of redemption, and the blood that protects us, that no devil can touch us because of the blood. Lord, we are not all the nationalities they say we are. We're one people, and we are one blood, and we've been unified by one blood. And that's the blood of Jesus. And we drink this cup. This is the covenant that we have with you. And we receive this now in Jesus' name. Praise God. Now, before we pray over the prayer requests, and I'll let you go, listen, who's going to be with us tonight? Who's coming tonight? Listen, is this a Super Bowl Sunday? No, in Jesus' name. You know, one year, it was Super Bowl Sunday. I had Rana Bonka come. We packed the place on Super Bowl Sunday. So, listen, this the greatest Super Bowl's happening here tonight. Forget about all that stuff. Forget about it. Stretch out your hand towards these prayer requests. Can you pray in the Holy Ghost right now over every person that called in? Father, grant miracles to every person that called. Each call represents a family, a home, children, a mother, parents, children, grandchildren, businesses, churches, ministries. Grant miracles to these precious ones. And we thank you for it. We thank you for it. And then, Lord, may people not be distracted by trivial nonsense with some men chasing leather with air in it today. May they come around your presence tonight. And we thank you for it. In Jesus' name. The only Super Bowl is going to be this bowl. Hallelujah. Praise God. We love you. Have you been blessed? Yeah. We'll see you tonight. Let's sing a song of rejoicing.
To the ancient of days.
carry that river of living water on the inside of you. You bring an oasis wherever you go. He will cause you and everything in your life to blossom. And if you'll just trust him, he can use you way beyond what you can imagine. God's plan for us is to flourish in every area of our life, our spirit, soul, and our body, personally, marriage, family, business. You're going to flourish like the palm tree. You're going to grow like the cedar. And you're going to carry that oasis where whoever you meet, if you go preach in a church, if you just meet someone on the street, you're carrying that oasis. You bring that refreshing. You bring that life everywhere that you go. You become the oasis.